Remember how recently we've been talking a lot about how the rise in climate alarmism by the international left is just a Trojan horse to collapse our way of life? Well, interestingly enough, I came across a piece written by the co-founder of the Extinction Rebellion movement who writes in his biography that he, quote, facilitates the emergence of diversity, openness, and complexity in our beautiful universe and resists oppression and exploitation. And in this piece entitled, quote, Extinction Rebellion isn't about the climate, he writes that the world's problems aren't in fact climate related, but rather the climate is merely a symptom of the toxic European culture that has plagued the world with things such as white supremacy, the patriarchy, Eurocentrism, the, quote, delusion of heterosexuality, and, quote, class hierarchy. We will examine the implications of this piece within the broader narrative. We will debunk every absurd claim that it makes, and we will strategize for the future of combating nonsense such as this. Do stay tuned.
John Doyle in. Heck off, Commie.
Hello there, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Heck Off, Commie. So, as we'll get into, I guess white supremacy is the reason third world countries keep burning through fossil fuels, but for those not yet aware, the Heck Off Commie website is now live. You can go there, buy your merchandise before it's gone. You can also support the channel by getting a subscription that gives you access to a bunch of exclusive benefits, things like live shows, voting on video ideas, submitting your own video ideas, monthly mailbag questions, stuff that won't be on YouTube. So go check that out at heckoffcommie.com. You can get access for less than the price of 2 gallons of gasoline. And then the lights stay on over here. So that's pretty cool. Also, anyone that gets a membership before November 1st will automatically be entered into a free merchandise giveaway. Follow in the footsteps of men like Joshua, John, and Jake. These absolute alpha males all got high IQ memberships. Names are going up on the wall in the studio because that's why we're here and that's who we work for. Oh, well, John, just take a sponsor. No! John buys a high IQ membership, signifying that he indeed has a high IQ. Was anyone surprised, really? Anyone really surprised that three alpha Western men with names starting with J happen to have a high IQ? No. No one is surprised because people with a J as one of their initials have an average IQ 4 standard deviations above the mean. That's the real IQ controversy. That's the real reason bell curves are controversial. I mean, that's such a controversial fact that even Charles Murray will not write about it. He refuses. But anyways, this piece comes to us from the co-founder of the Extinction Rebellion, and if you're not familiar with their work, I will provide to you a brief synopsis.
Hi guys, we're Extinction Rebellion. We're here at Canning Town Station. Here we have government. This action is not targeted to disrupt people on the tube. This action is targeted at government. The activists here are expressing their rage, their frustration. We do not enjoy disrupting passengers on the tube, but there is no option here.
So yeah, that's basically what they're on about, but I will read to you from their website because on the website they describe themselves as, quote, an international movement that uses nonviolent civil disobedience in an attempt to halt mass extinction and minimize the risk of social collapse. And then under their The Truth tab, which ostensibly contains the reasons for which they are acting, they write that, quote, the science is clear. It is understood that we are facing an unprecedented global emergency. We are in a life or death situation of our own making. We must act now. So already their message is overflowing with untrue alarmist rhetoric. I mean, in their description, they beg the question by declaring that the mass extinction is already underway, along with the risk of social collapse. This is happening, it's settled, and in fact, it's because this is happening that we exist in the first place, because we exist to combat this, or at least that's what we've written on our website. Never mind that the adjacent ideas that these people have, which we'll talk more about in a second, never mind that these ideas of creating a just and equitable society through government control, never mind that it's ideas like that which have managed to take the lives of tens of millions of people, incite civil unrest, famine, war, etc. Never mind that because there is no because that transcends this childish and ignorant idea of, well, that wasn't true socialism, that wasn't true communism, I know how to actually do it because I'm 23 years old and I have a linguistics degree and a poster of Che on the wall in my 450 square foot apartment, but hey, at least I still live in New York, right? And I don't like that my standard of living in New York is less than the Trump families, even though I work at Starbucks and sell watercolor paintings of naked fat people because it's art, question mark? I don't even know. I don't understand it, but yep, proletarians unite. It's like we laugh at it, but that's literally the composition of the movement. But anyways, all that's under there, the truth section, is this conglomeration of cherry-picked pseudoscience that serves to establish credibility for their claim that we're facing extinction as a species, hence their name, Extinction Rebellion. They are rebelling against the extinction of the human race, or so they document on their website. So we'll go through the article now, but just to provide some context, speaking to the analysis of broader trends, environmentalism, the climate crisis, this mainstream promotion of climate alarmism buttressed by misrepresented science, it's all just a Trojan horse for more government. That's objectively true. That's not even a biased take. Because what we're hearing is, oh, we've got problems A, B, C, and the only way that we can solve them is if the government does X, Y, Z. So they're not even trying to hide that. That's literally the plan, except that the plan is often overlooked by the public, who is at this point distracted by, wow, I can't believe we're going to go extinct. Bummer. That poor little girl, we robbed her of her childhood. Oh, just do whatever you want to us, government. Just please fix the catastrophe. It's like, it's completely by design. We saw this in September of 1990 when Robert Heilbronner, a famous American socialist economist, wrote in New York Magazine that despite the collapse of the USSR, he still did not endorse capitalism, but rather he advocated for his fellow socialists to turn to regulation, particularly environmental regulation under the guise of saving the planet. He said that regulation could be just as effective as government ownership of the means of production. He said that they should highlight, quote, the ecological burden that economic growth is placing on the environment, and also that they should say that markets may be better at allocating resources, but only socialism could avoid ecological disaster. And we see this now, when AOC's chief of staff gets caught admitting that the Green New Deal wasn't even about the environment in the first place. The Green New Deal, which contains full employment pledges, guaranteed income for people simply unwilling to work. I mean, just open your eyes. Just look at the trends. Look at the patterns. It's all by design. It's all coordinated. They're just herding the sheep. Or the NPC, sheep is a boomer term, because they use that in Animal Farm. They're just inputting commands for the NPCs. They're just using the physics gun from Gmod, and they're just throwing them across the map. That's what they're doing. So, on to the article. This was authored by a man named Stuart Bastin, who was the co-founder of Extinction Rebellion. He begins by writing that he is aware that the climate is breaking down, he's aware of the urgency, and he's aware that we only have a few years left to fix it, and he wraps the word fix in quotations, implying that he doesn't actually believe that we can fix it. He expands that implication by writing that weather patterns are going to become increasingly unstable and increasingly unpredictable. Harvests will fall across entire continents, food costs will increase, millions have already suffered from the instability, we're facing societal collapse, and all of our lives are soon going to radically change. Okay, one at a time. Firstly, the rhetorical strategy for this entire piece is to paint vague images in the reader's head by employing vague and generalized statements so as to allude to the media coverage working alongside him. This is referred to in psychology as the availability heuristic, basically that we seek to interpret information in ways that align with what's readily available in our memory. So we see stories in the media talking about global catastrophe because the climate crisis. We see Greta, we see AOC, and then you read a piece like this and you're inclined to believe it because it reaffirms everything that you remember the TV people telling you. So the first claim about weather patterns becoming increasingly unstable and unpredictable, he's alluding to hurricanes. But there's been shown to be no association between levels of CO2 in the atmosphere and the prevalence of hurricanes. There was a study from Stockholm University that concluded that the greatest increase in uncertainty was going to be with regards to our ability to predict how much it's going to rain in the summertime. And that's not to say that there's going to be absolutely no effect, but it's like, come on, dude. Like, do you think we're all going to be LARPing as Kevin Costner? You think we're all going to be living in Waterworld? And again, that's the reason for the vague language. Because if he were to be specific and write, our lives are all going to radically change, we might have more trouble predicting rain in the summer. It would just be like, it would be laughable. So instead, he's intentionally vague so as to cause the reader to jump to conclusions rooted in their own availability heuristic. With growing food, that's tricky. Because increased levels of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere cause increased crop yields, obviously. That's what the plants eat. But there are other things that could offset that benefit, such as droughts and increased salinity in water. But again, this idea that humans are incapable of reacting to these types of obstacles is just demonstrably untrue. But right now, we're just focused on, given climate change and these effects, should we socialism? That's basically the question for the time being, because we're ignoring that human beings aren't causing climate change right now. We're having a relatively small impact on what's already happening through our additional CO2 emissions. Atmospheric CO2 levels have fluctuated on this planet for literally billions of years. There's not a whole lot we can do about that, even if we completely stopped. The difference would be minuscule at best in the grand scheme of things. And the other thing he says there, there's millions of people already suffering. Again, people read that and they're like, yeah, probably, honestly. Like, there's no way to argue against that. He's responsible for the burden of proof and he's provided to us nothing. Moving on. He writes that none of this is even controversial. He provides an analogy in which a bus is about to hit a guy to illustrate the point that there's a certain point where one realizes that disaster is imminent. He writes that that's us now because the bus is about to hit us and it's not clear whether or not we will survive. And that's not even a big deal because species go extinct all the time. Now, I've said this before and I'll say it again. I'm team human every day. A lot of these leftist characters, they consider it to be speciesist to prioritize humans over other species. They're dumb. They want to sacrifice their lives running into a building to save a frog. Be my guest. We need your weak genes out of team human anyways. But that aside, I would make the argument that the human race going extinct is a much more significant event than an insect or bird species with which you weren't even familiar with as a child going extinct. it's a halfway decent metric, right? Like, if I didn't know what that animal says back in first grade, it's probably not worth crying over if it's just, you know, gone forever. And that's not to say that we should go out of our way to facilitate that extinction. It's just to ask, to what degree should we inhibit ourselves trying to save species that are naturally going extinct, because that's what nature does from time to time, just so we can feel good about ourselves. And so he uses this fact of human extinction to segue into his founding and continued involvement with Extinction Rebellion. And here's where it gets really fun. He writes, "And I'm here to say that Extinction Rebellion isn't about the climate. You see, the climate's breakdown is a symptom of a toxic system that has infected the ways we relate to each other as humans and to all life. This was exacerbated when European civilization was spread around the globe through cruelty and violence, especially over the last 600 years of colonialism, although the roots of the infections go much further back." Are you having fun? I'm having fun. Firstly, I love the quotes around civilization. Like, this really just condescending, like, civilization. As if European as if Western civilization isn't the gold standard of living. As if it's not the frame of reference through which we evaluate other cultures. And hey, if you don't like it, you can leave. You can go away. But you won't, because people vote with their feet. And regardless of how edgy and esoteric you've decided that it is to hate on Western civilization, at the end of the day, you know it's the best, which is why you're here. And it's fine. I get it. Your ego invested in this. It's okay. You don't have to admit it to me, but you know it's true. And the problem he has here, though, isn't actually with colonialism, it's with European colonialism. And we know this because he writes a lot about how European colonialism lasted for hundreds of years and brought cruelty and violence, and it was just the absolute worst, even though its roots go back farther. It's like, yeah, you're right. The concept of taking control of other countries and exploiting them for your benefit does go a bit farther back than those damn Europeans, but I wish you'd have elaborated on that observation. He continues, "As Europeans spread their toxicity around the world, they brought torture, genocide, carnage, and suffering to the ends of the earth. Their cultural myths justified their horrors, such as the idea that indigenous people were animals, not humans, and therefore God had given us dominion over them. This was used to justify a multi-continent-wide genocide of tens of millions of people. The coming of the scientific era saw this intensify as the world around us was increasingly seen as dead matter, just sitting there waiting for us to exploit and use it up. We're now using it up faster than ever." This is interesting because he's trying to draw a parallel between colonialism and the use of fossil fuels by saying that it's through the normalization of the idea that we can use and exploit things for our benefit that this idea of using up our resources came to fruition. The problem is that the thought isn't being traced back to its roots. In other words, I think this individual is trying to blame the human tendency to use things to one's own advantage on colonialism, when in fact it could be more accurately blamed on the fact that it's a human tendency. That's what people do. That's what animals do. They act in their best interest. Like, hey, I need to feed my family. Oh, well, don't kill the cow. Hey, I need to heat my house. Well, wait, don't burn that. It's like, yeah, okay, buddy. Blame human nature on colonialism. Also, I'm not necessarily defending colonialism, but can we acknowledge that without colonialism, the modern world would not exist? Or would we rather stand on the shoulders of our forefathers and make them apologize to us for bringing us the greatest standard of living in the history of the world? It gets better. "Euro-Americans violently imposed and taught dangerous delusions that they used to justify the exploitation and reinforce our dominance while silencing worldviews that differed or challenged them. The UK's hand in this was enormous, as can be seen by the size of the former British Empire and the dominance of the English language around the world. There is stark evidence that everyday racial bias continues in Britain now today. It's worth naming some of these constructed delusions that have been coded into societies and institutions around the world." Okay, before we go through these delusions that he's describing and how they're constructed and dangerous, note how he's specifically talking about English colonialism. The reason for that is because when he says European, he means white people. That's it. Do you think he's talking about the Spanish and Portuguese colonizers, even though they're the Europeans that got the ball rolling on this whole colonialism thing? You think this guy would dare condemn those damn Hispanics? Was that what he meant when he mentioned that there were roots to this? That the roots of British colonialism are in Spanish colonialism? Would this white leftist ever dare condemn anyone that is not white? No, not a chance. But those damn white people? Yes, very likely, because it soothes his weird guilt and suits his little neo-Marxist agenda. But now we'll go through what he describes as the dangerous delusions that have been spread by this European colonialism, aka British colonialism, I guess. First, "The delusion of white supremacy centers whiteness in the experience of white people, constructing and perpetuating the myth that white people and their lives are somehow inherently better and more valuable than people of color." No one ever says that. It's funny because the only people that you will ever hear say the words "white people and their lives are more valuable than people of color" are these white leftists. And then they're like, "No, I was just telling you what you believe. I don't believe it. You do. And I was just reminding you." It's like, okay, yeah, thank you for that. What he means by this, at least I think, is that we tend to regard the lifestyles of European countries as better than the lifestyles of non-European countries. And the reason for that is like, it's just because they're objectively better. And that's not my opinion. I don't believe that. So don't get mad at me. I'm just reporting to you the data I found that displays to where hundreds of millions of people would move if they had the choice. And they said countries like the United States, Canada, Germany, France, United Kingdom, Saudi Arabia. There you go. There's your outlier. Spain, etc. So you get the point. People vote with their feet, and assuming they're capable of valuing something as greater than something else, there's your hierarchy. That would mean that they would want to move to the place that they perceive to be the best, and they're consistently reporting that Western countries are the best. Sure, you'll get a Saudi Arabia, you'll throw in a Japan from time to time, but the trend is clear, the West is the best, baby. And I don't believe that. Please don't yell at me. I'm just telling you what all those bigoted sub-Saharan Africans were saying. Also, I believe he mentioned something about racism in the UK so that he could continue to ascribe this notion of white supremacy. Here's the thing about racism. It's always going to exist in the world. Same way murder and rape, it's always going to be there. And because of that, the best way to evaluate racism would probably be on a relative scale, right? Like, hey, let's see how our racism is doing versus their racism. And it turns out that the most racist, most intolerant countries in the world are countries in Africa and countries in the Middle East, whereas Western countries, including the United States and the UK, are among the least racist and most tolerant countries in the world, except for France. But no one likes them either, so it's whatever. Oh, I do not want you to be my neighbor. Je ne veux pas que tu sois mon voisin. It's like, I don't even want you on my planet. Go get Napoleon's great, great, great grandson. Send him to Mars. Just get the hell out. I'm joking. We love the French, even though evidently they don't like other people. But next one, the delusion of patriarchy centers the male experience and excludes slash hinders female assigned people. Oh my God. From public life, reducing them to a possession or object for ownership or consumption, patriarchy teaches dominating and competitive behaviors and emphasizes the idea that the world is a place of scarcity, separation, and powerlessness. First of all, let's define patriarchy because they like to expand the definition of patriarchy to include natural and fundamental aspects of human behavior so as to help them in constructing their everything is socially constructed narratives. So according to Merriam-Webster, patriarchy is defined as social organization marked by the supremacy of the father in the clan or family, the legal dependence of wives and children, and the reckoning of descent and inheritance in the male line. Many feminists regard post-World War II, 50s America as the height of the patriarchy as evidenced by the domestic housewife stereotype. But in 1959, there was a study done that showed that most day-to-day household decisions were made by the mothers, and larger decisions were shared by both parents 80% of the time, and exclusively made by fathers only 20% of the time. That doesn't exactly scream paternal supremacy to me. And you know, there's a joke from Albert Einstein that I think conveys the attitude of it quite well. He said, "When we first got married, we made a pact. It was this. In our life together, it was decided I would make all of the big decisions and my wife would make all of the little decisions. For 50 years, we have held true to that agreement. I believe that it is the reason for the success of our marriage, or in our marriage rather. However, the strange thing is that in 50 years, there hasn't been one big decision." If you're still hesitant to believe that from just the data, really ask yourself, was your grandpa oppressing your grandma? Really? Do you believe your father is oppressing your mother? Really? Really? Obviously not. And of course, you can find toxic relationships in every generation, but as a general rule, no. The second characteristic of patriarchy is the legal dependence of wives and children. This too is not characteristic of the West. Single women are working full-time. Married women are still working. They are in no way legally dependent on their husbands for anything. Children are legally dependent on their fathers, but also on their mothers. So that also does not scream patriarchy to me. And the third characteristic being the reckoning of descent in the male line, which to my understanding means that because traditionally women change their last names to that of their husbands, women are oppressed. I mean, like, okay, I think that's the least alarming of the three, and I think that women largely don't have a problem with this. 80% of women choose to change their last names, and that number is actually slowly declining as more women are choosing to keep their maiden names. And the key takeaway from that is their choice. If it were a patriarchal society, there would be no choice. At this point, the tradition is just like something to swoon over, effectively. Because this was brought, oh boy, this was brought up in one of my English classes in high school. Second wave feminism in general, there were a lot of girls quick to raise their hands, complain about the patriarchy, complain about how they're oppressed. And then our teacher, a classic old school feminist, said that, by the way, taking your husband's last name is a form of oppression. Their energy just dropped. They started eating each other alive. Like, wait, but that's cute. I want that. So as far as patriarchy teaching dominating and competitive behaviors, no, that's just human nature. And if you let it do its thing unhindered, you'll end up with competition. Also, the implication there is since we have to do away with patriarchy because patriarchy equals bad, we have to do away with the competition that patriarchy brings, which means no more free markets. Very clever, but also very untrue. Next, the delusions of Eurocentrism include the notion that Europeans know what is best for the world. I definitely don't think Europeans know what's best for the world in all cases, but in some cases we do. I say we as in we the West. Maybe it's stupid of us to get involved in these conflicts. Maybe it's stupid of specifically European countries to mass import people from the third world. We can have those debates. But as far as stuff like not mutilating female genitalia, not throwing acid on people, having functioning plumbing, I don't know. I'd make the case that we do know what's best as a general rule, and I think everyone else would make the same case since they all want to come live in Western countries. Here's my favorite. The delusions of heterosexism / heteronormativity propagate the idea that heterosexuality is, quote, normal, and that other expressions of sexuality are deviant. In other words, being attracted to the opposite gender, aka the reason that we are all here, is actually a construct that was brought to us by white colonialism. Bruh, like, come on. Western countries are the most accepting of non-heterosexual behavior. Go try to have a pride parade in Nigeria or Afghanistan. You'll die. You'll literally be killed. Also, being heterosexual is normal. I love how he puts that in quotes, like, normal. Bruh. Not everyone is gay. Not everyone cares. In fact, most people don't care. The only people with enough time on their hands to pretend that everyone is so concerned about who they're attracted to are people living in prosperous, just Western countries. Like, if you were in the Middle East and you're like, this culture makes me feel excluded, they'd be like, yes, I know. And then they'd stone you to death. Whereas here in the West, you say it, and then you get a bunch of white liberals feeling bad for you, throwing money at you, offering you endorsements, giving you attention. What made heterosexuality normal wasn't British colonialism. It was God, or if you don't believe in God, it was literally the instant the first man saw the first woman. If Western colonialism spread these ideas about heterosexuality being the only normal and accepted identity, you'd expect Western countries to have very few gay people and to be very intolerant towards gay people, since I guess it was their idea in the first place, but such is just not the case. It's actually the exact opposite. Western countries have more gay people and more tolerance towards gay people. It's the non-Western countries that are the exact opposite. Last one. The delusions of class hierarchy uphold the theory that the rich elite are better / smarter / nobler than the rest of us and therefore make better decisions. No one says this. This is just more Marxist nonsense. I had a philosophy professor try to make this argument to our class one time. She was a Marxist. It's totally false. Class hierarchy upholds the theory that the rich elite are better / smarter / more noble and therefore make better decisions. Very sneaky and very pernicious. He writes that they are better / smarter / nobler than the rest of us. He's spamming positive words that represent a relatively greater quantity of whichever concept is being reflected. The reason that is done is so the reader reads quickly through them, assuming they're all related because of the repetition and because they're conjoined via slashes. But those words all mean very different things. There is a relationship between one's wealth and one's intelligence, but there is no relationship between one's nobility and one's wealth, or one's being better or being worse. And that's why he starts the series of adjectives with better, because it's vague and therefore allows for the other adjectives to enter and basically be ignored by the reader because the reader thinks that they're just all related to the concept of better and virtue, since we would all prefer to be better and smarter and nobler. But the only one of these variables that can actually predict wealth is your intelligence, or maybe whether or not you're better if we're talking about how good you are at making money relative to other people. And then he flips the relationship by saying, therefore, they make better decisions, implying that colonialism has spread the idea that if people are rich, they make better decisions, when in fact, the opposite is the case, which is that if people make good decisions, they are more likely to be rich. And the West has provided opportunities for that to be actualized through our freedom. And that's exactly what has happened. So he goes on to finish by saying that all of these delusions have been ingrained in us by being taught at a young age. He doesn't get more specific than that, but just trust him that human nature, as he's described, is actually just a social construct. Also, why are Americans affected by British colonialism? We fought against that and won. Why do I feel like this is also an indictment on America? Like, we fought against the British colonists, like, we're on your team, sort of. And he writes that none of these delusions have ended and they continue to play out in all of us, for example, thinking the United States is good. Okay, and so the task of Extinction Rebellion is to dispel these delusions because the climate is merely a symptom of the cause, which is this list of toxic delusions, and also it's racist and sexist, and we have to decolonize ourselves. Okay, now he's going into his weird guilt. He wants to pay reparations. Bruh, just please be done. He's reiterating the connection he's drawn between colonialism and people using resources and, I guess, buying gifts on Christmas. And the result of this is isolation. Yeah. Okay, so he's just getting into more Marxist rhetoric. And then he finishes by saying Extinction Rebellion isn't about the climate. It's about getting rid of these delusions. And that's what I love about his word choice. I love the employment of the word delusion, which literally means something that contrasts reality, a separation between something and reality. His organization, preaching the extinction of the human race, advocating for the elimination of thinking being straight is normal, advocating against human competition. Is that normal? Or is that delusional? I don't know. It's a tough question, but I will save you the brain power. It's delusional. It's completely delusional, and that's the thing. It doesn't have to not be delusional, because it's not purporting to be logical. It's not purporting to be rational. It's designed to be alarming. It's designed to make people emotional and to channel their unquestioning support through that emotional response, and that's exactly what it's doing. That's exactly what we're seeing. They're admitting it. It isn't about the environment. It's about destroying what they believe caused this problem in the first place, which is the West, which is America. And if they have to pretend it's about the environment on the surface to manipulate people into supporting their agenda, so what? Makes no difference to them. Who cares if every time we've tried socialism, it resulted in mass starvation and death? It's going to happen anyways, according to our cherry-picked pseudoscientific data that we honestly don't even care about. Like that much to begin with, because we're not necessarily pro-environment, we're just anti-Western civilization, because Western civilization creates hierarchies, and we always end up on the bottom of those hierarchies because we're dumb and bad at being independent, and so we just resent the whole system in the first place. So, you know, we may as well give socialism a try. Again. Epic. Hey guys, if you like this video, give it a big thumbs up. Give it a big comment with your thoughts, and of course, give it a big subscribe to the channel, and you can actually now give it a big visit to heckoffcommie.com. You can purchase merchandise. You can purchase a subscription that will give you access to exclusive content, live show, all sorts of benefits. It's all summarized in depth on the website. You should check it out. It's a pretty cool website. Very cool. Thank you, Wyatt. Very cool. But anyways, thank you so much for watching, and may God bless America. Pew!